Good morning, everyone. As was already announced, in this talk, I would like to talk about assisted HiPIMS discharges. As mentioned, this work was done at the University of Greifswald in Germany, together with our colleagues and friends from Academy of Sciences in Prague in the Czech Republic. First of all, I would like to give you some rough content of my contribution. And at the beginning, I would like to explain you the motivation and aims, what we are doing and why, and one explain what means the HiPIMS or HiPIMS assisted discharges. Actually, the most important will be the second part, where I want to talk about the experimental device which have been developed in our laboratory in in last two years. Maybe I should use the other computer.
Yes.
Oh. Yeah, I have it on USB stick, so yeah, maybe just now I can somewhat continue and Oh, I'm sorry for that. Okay, the doubling. Just now it seems that somewhat works. So this talk will be strongly oriented on the plasma diagnostic using the Langmuir probe measurements and also the ion distribution function, optical emission spectroscopy, and so on. We can somewhat follow the discussion which was related with the last question or the last comment regarding the Hari talks, and here we can see that this is that there exists some so-called structural zone diagram, the last one proposed by Andre Anders, and from that we can see that this is mostly the energy of incoming particles and the temperature of the substrate which influence the crystallography structure of the thin films. A couple of minutes ago, we heard a very nice talk given by Harry, and everything important about the HiPIMS discharges was already mentioned. Just I would like to remind one of the most important benefit of the HiPIMS discharges, and that's it, that the HiPIMS can provide high level of ionized sputtered species, which are usually metal species. And that's also known that the films which are produced by the ion deposition has the different properties. The other advantage is that we can guide those charged particles. We can tune or control the energy using the bias or biasing and so on. So that's our major aim. We try to operate the HiPIMS discharges, but at wide range of experimental conditions. And then in that way, we try to optimize the HiPIMS processes and to tailor the properties of deposited films. I have promised that I don't want to talk too much about the deposition of the films, but just only the motivation. In our laboratory, we are dealing mostly with the deposition of titanium copper thin films, which are required to have the defined copper release, which can be done due to the different crystallography structure. Further, we are dealing with the deposition of oxides films, and we can remember the comment of Richard van der Sanden from yesterday talk, who presented this, for example, the titanium oxide dioxide can be deposited in different crystallographic structures regarding the incoming energy. In that case, that was controlled by the bias. I will show you some similar effect. I don't want to repeat what was already mentioned. We are using the high power impulse magnetron sputtering that's driven typically with the frequency of 100 Hz and duty cycle of about 1%. But in our laboratory, we are not dealing with the conventional HiPIMS discharges. we are dealing with the pre-ionosite HiPIMS, where this pre-ionizator serves as a, or it provides the seat of charge in the delay or in the idle part of the pulses, which somewhat supports the reignition of the HiPIMS discharges. And in that way, we are able to reduce the pressure. Actually, this topic is not completely new. We are not the pioneers. As you can see, 2 years ago or 3 years ago, there were already published such a works where the pre-ionizator was used. For example, the simultaneous drilling of the DC magnetron sputtering or glow discharge, or the group of Ralph Vandorf reported the mid-frequency support. In that talk, I want to describe the two experimental devices. The first is the so-called hybrid dual HiPIMS, and then ECWVR assisted discharges. I hope that I will manage that. So first of all, I would like to talk about the hybrid dual HiPIMS. And first, I want to explain actually even what does it mean. You can see that the experimental device is quite simple, that just two sputtering guns are installed in the vacuum chamber. The rotational table is installed below them, and there are placed the samples, so we are able to achieve the homogeneous coating. Actually, this device, or the purpose for why we have developed it, that's the deposition of titanium and copper thin films. And these two materials have the different sputtering yield, which we have to somewhat eliminate to get the proper stoichiometry. For that reason, I would like to explain what we did, or what is the connect, or what is the electric scheme. This is just only the dual HiPIMS, and you can see that the electrical scheme consists of two HiPIMS loops. This is the first one loop, this is the second loop. They are nearly identical. Each is using the DC unit, or DC power supply unit, and then a home-built power switch. As it is working, you can see here in the first step is activated the first loop. The titanium serves as a cathode, the copper serves as an anode, and we have the first pulse, which is related with the titanium sputtering. In the next step, the second loop is activated and sputtered is a copper, which serves as a cathode after the delay of a few microseconds. Such a configuration we used to call as a dual HiPIMS. Yeah, it's just only the name. And with such a configuration, we are able to provide the sputtering with the pressure of about the units of Pascal. Typically, that we try to get a little bit higher pressure, about 3 pascals. I can explain later why. And if we want to reduce the pressure during such a type of the sputtering, we need to employ some pre-ionizator. In our case, this is caused by the mid-frequency power supply, which is connected directly towards the cathodes via some transformer. In such a configuration, we are able to reduce the pressure up to about one order of magnitude, up to 0.3. That's a little bit less, but that doesn't play the role here. I should mention that in this case, we are this discharge or these two loops are completely independent, and the whole discharge is the whole system is fully floating. That's divided from the ground. So does it mean that the discharge operated between those two electrodes, which alternatively serves as an anode and a cathode? So this discharge is driven by some electrical confinement, and also by the magnetic confinement. These figures just now are somewhat damaged, but there is a different polarity of the magnetic field. Okay, here is some message. Something is wrong. Yeah. Oh, okay. Let's continue. My last comments were about the confinement, electric and magnetic confinement, which finally results in this bounding between the discharges. And again, you can see that that's operated between the anode and the cathode. Here you can see the measured potential, the potentials which were measured on the cathode with respect of the ground. And once again here at the zero, the start first titanium HiPIMS pulse, then the delay between the pulses. Here is the copper HiPIMS pulse, and in the idle time of the HiPIMS pulses is driven the mid-frequency discharge. Actually, the frequencies are different. The HiPIMS is driven with the frequency about 100 Hz, while the mid-frequency about 100 kHz. And for that reason, we can see that also the discharge currents are quite different. During the HiPIMS pulse, we have got about 50 amps per square centimeter, which corresponds with the current density about 2.5 amps per square centimeter. While here, for example, this mid-discharge current is quite lower. This is below half of amp or 1 amp. We can see here that the polarity of the discharge current is different, but that's okay because we have to keep in mind that was measured by the oscilloscopic probe on one electrode, and this one electrode for the first pulse serves as the anode, and for the second pulse as a cathode. So the polarity is changed, and that's even the proof that we have the really fully dual HiPIMS magnetron, which is floating and not connected with the ground. The images are somewhat damaged, so I will skip them. We have just only what we did. We also employed a dynamic study of the discharges, how they are developing. We used for that the optical emission imaging, and we can find how is done this bounding, which propagates first from the titanium target, and then is created. The cloud of the species which are going deposited downwards. We also make the video from that, but I think that I'm already late with my time, and typically it's not working in my case, and even today I don't think so that I will present it. But anyhow, this emissions which we measured via the total emission. And here we can see the species which are responsible for that. Here are compared also the different pressures. We can see that at low pressure, the dominant are the lines which are related with the metal ion species, the copper plus and the titanium plus, while just only a few lines of non-ionized metal were applied as titanium and copper. At higher pressure, the structure somewhat is different, so that we can somewhat assume that the lower pressure enhance the ionization processes. Actually, we were also interested about the electron density, which is shown here. This is the time evolution. This one is the first titanium HiPIMS pulse, then follows the delay between the HiPIMS pulses, the copper HiPIMS pulse, and then the mid-frequency discharge. And here are shown the three lines. First, I would like to report this one. This is the blue one, which is regarded with dual HiPIMS at higher pressure. And we can see that we have observed the maximum value at the end of the HiPIMS pulse. But if we are operating the same device with the help or with the assistance of mid-frequency discharge at the same pressure, we can see that the development is faster, which is quite important for us, and also the electron density is enhanced. One of the most important is this line, where is operated the hybrid dual HiPIMS at low pressure, and we can see that this is even the faster, and the electron density became somewhat constant. Actually, one can claim that the absolute value is lower, but that's okay. We have to keep in mind that the pressure is lower, about one order of magnitude. So it means that the total amount of the species is lower. And if you recalculate it on the level of the ionization coefficient, that it's even higher, about several percent. We also estimated the mean electron energy. You can see that we have got the quite high energies at the beginning of the pulse, and then we observe the fall of the energies. That's somewhat typical. That was also shown in Harry's talk. That's typically explained by the energy losses for the ionization of metal species. But in our case, the energy became higher. This is about 3 electron volts, which again can enhance the ionization. These quantities were estimated from the measured electron energy probabilities functions, which you can see here. And only a few comments. Here you can see, or this color line belongs to HiPIMS discharges, and you can see that the energies were about 10-15 electron volts in the tail, and that's cross the energy which corresponds with the ionization potential of metal species, especially if we compare that with the mid-frequency discharges, are these two lines, which is just only a few electron volts, and typically they are of more Maxwellian shape. The electron energies and the electrons are important for the discharge, how it works and how it develops and so on. But since in our laboratory we are dealing mostly with the deposition of the electrons, the information about the ion energies and about the energy of the incoming particles is even important for us. And we try to measure it using the retarding field analyzer. This graph was already shown somewhat by David or by Harry. We can see that 3D image here is the time, this is the energy, and these are the distribution functions. Once again, this is the first titanium HiPIMS pulse, the second copper pulse, and here this energetic tail corresponds with mid-frequency discharge. And actually, next I would like to show you just only these 2D projections. Here are the distribution of ion energies for the hybrid dual HiPIMS, but one's driven at pressure of 3 Pascal and one's 0.3 Pascal, so low pressure and high pressure. Immediately we can see that the effect of the pressure on the ions. Here the energy is slower, while here we have the broad distributions which are higher energies. That was already studied in our previous paper, that typically we have observed some delay between the pulses. That's about 25 microseconds, and we somewhat explained it by the prevailing time which needs the ions to get the retarding field analyzer sensor. Unfortunately, I didn't present this video, but that's well corresponds with this video which we have made. Then you can see how the energies or how the electrons are enhanced, how the cloud is formed, and how it's propagating downwards towards the target. That's just something like the first part which is related with the hybrid dual HiPIMS discharge, and we found that due to the different energy we are able somewhat to control the due to the pressure we are able to control the energy and also the level of the ionization. Further, what is somewhat positive is that such a type of the discharge we are employing also for the combined PECVD and the HiPIMS discharges, because these chemicals and precursor and vapors can be activated by this mid-frequency pulse. And this somewhat or this gives us the motivation even to try to reduce the pressure even more, and for that reason we have developed a second device which is called ECWVR and the HiPIMS discharge. First of all, I would like to explain what means the ECWVR. That's the electron cyclotron wave resonance, and this is a quite complex phenomena which results from the interaction of the electromagnetic wave and plasma in volume with superimposed magnetic field. In reality, that's done like that the discharge, the RF discharge is created inside a single RF single turn RF electrode, and the magnetic field is propagated by the pair of Helmholtz coils. And then this magnetic anisotropicity allows the propagation of right-handed circularly polarized mode of electromagnetic wave. here we can see this dispersion diagram, and the energies which are above the electron cyclotron frequency, they are, or the refractive index of the plasma is imaginary, so that's not important for us. For us is are important the energies which are below the electron cyclotron frequency, and here not so far exists some special region where the electron cyclotron waves can be achieved. And for that, for us, the most important is the case when the half of the wavelengths of the electron cyclotron wave somewhat corresponds with the size of the plasma, because then occurs the standing wave, standing pattern of the electromagnetic wave, and we are talking about the resonance conditions. To tune this size of the discharge, tune the size or the length of this electron cyclotron wave, we are using the variable magnetic field, because this is a one parameter which influences the refractive index of the plasma. So once the resonance is achieved, then the ECWVR discharge is ignited. And actually, I should clearly say that this idea is known about 40 years, and also the ECWVR discharges are known quite well. So that's our outcome here is a zero. We are just only trying to use the benefits of such a type of the discharges, and that's it. That produces quite homogeneous discharge, which a high level of ionization, but especially that belongs to the family of helicon discharges, which can be operated in a lower pressure. And what we did, we have installed a sputtering source in the middle, or in this we installed the sputtering source inside the ECWVR facility. And working together, we are able to work with the pressure which is reduced up to 0.01 Pascal. So that's nearly about two orders of magnitude lower than it is some conventional pressure. So here you can see how it is developed. The ECWVR discharge is created somewhere in this single turn RF electrode. The sputtering source is inserted inside this ECWVR facility, and that's driven with the with a pulse generator. Actually, here you can see that this ECWVR facility with the sputtering source is inbuilt somewhere on the lower part of the chamber. The upper flange serves as a port for the diagnostic tools, and also to accommodate the energy resolved mass. Mass spectrometer. Some results what we have achieved. I have reported, or I mentioned that in such a configuration we are able to achieve the pressure 0.01 Pascal, even slightly less, but then that's more problematic. But this is for non-reactive mixtures, and this device or this setup or this experiment was related with the deposition of titanium oxide films. For that reason, we have employed a fully reactive argon oxygen mixture, which is where the ratio is equal to one, and that was operated at pressure about 0.075 Pascal. Actually, first we can see that here is the current density, which achieved about 3 amps per square centimeter, and this development is quite fast. This is the most important. One of the most important feature that the development is quite fast. We are obtaining the maximum after 10 or 15 microseconds, and then the current is nearly the constant. So that can enhance the sputtering. We got interesting information from the measurement of RF voltage that was measured directly on the RF electrode. And here we can see that there are something like the three regions. This is the first one where is operated the pure ECWVR discharge, so that's the resonant conditions, everything is fine. But then when the HiPIMS discharge is activated, we observe some transition. This is caused by the production of the electrons, because during the HiPIMS pulse, the electron density increases significantly. And since the electron density is one of the parameter which influence the refractive number of the plasma, the resonance conditions are shifted. So here, when the discharge, HiPIMS discharge is running, we are not operating the ECWVR, but this is just only some support of some RF discharge. And the ECWVR occurs after the end of the HiPIMS pulse, when the plasma decays, HiPIMS plasma decays, the electron density decreases, and again the resonant conditions are established. Here you can see the spectras, overview of spectra, which we have measured. And that was already mentioned in our letter communication, that at lower pressure and in pure argon discharge, nearly all sputtered species are ionized, with significant fraction of double ionized species. You can see it here in the spectra. The highest intensity belongs to titanium plus plus, or so here you can see this line, and a lot of lines which is related with the titanium plus. If the oxygen is added, then the dominant became the argon plus, or the argon ions which are created in the discharge volume, and this is also the time average spectrum. So we have to take in account the contribution of the ECWVR. But still we can see that this shape of sputtered species are somewhat similar. So this effect of the target poisoning, which is related with the oxygen presence in the chamber, we can see here. This is a pure argon once again. Or here are presented just some selected spectral lines which were measured in a time resolved mode. In argon, again, the highest intensity belongs to titanium plus plus, then nearly about one order of magnitude lower titanium plus, then some argon. But if we compare it with the oxygen mixture, we can see that the dominant became the argon plus created in the volume, because the total amount of the species is reduced due to the poisoning of the target and due to the lower sputtering yield of oxide on the top. But if we are going to estimate the ratios between the titanium plus plus and titanium plus for argon and for argon and oxygen, then we can see that they are somewhat comparable. This is not, there is some agreement, better to say. And from that we can somewhat, we can think that these ionization processes are still play a role even in these oxygen mixtures. Here again, we estimate the basic parameters of the discharges. First, I can spend a few words about the electron density. The absolute value is about 10 to 18 electrons per per cubic meter. And once we have to keep in mind that this is the fully reactive mixture and at lower pressure. So if we estimate the ionization coefficient, that's quite high. The absolute maximum is achieved somewhere here after the 25 microseconds, and then it is decreases. We think that this effect of the decrease might be connected with the creation of negative oxygen ions by the electron attachment, but this is still an open question. We also measure the energy of electrons. Here you can see that again we observe the higher energies are related with the ECWVR discharge that decreases during the HiPIMS pulse, but that's again about, for example, 6 electron volts, which is much higher and might be, for example, utilized for the ionization of sputtered species with a high ionization potential, for example, as it was proposed with carbon during the deposition of diamond, the diamond-like carbon layers in a link shopping group. Also, we measure the potential. We can see that the potential is about 25 volts in ECWVR discharge, and during the HiPIMS that decreases. Even the negative values at the beginning of the HiPIMS discharges was reported, and in our case that was always positive, about 7 electron volts. Here you can see the measured energy distributions function for the electrons at the beginning of the discharge of the HiPIMS pulse. the distribution is somewhat deviated from the Maxwellian one, then follows the some stage when the Maxwellian distribution is observed, and we can estimate two Maxwellian groups. For example, here is the first one, this is the second one. And after some time, when the discharge is fully developed, then due to the collisions of the electrons, the distribution is typically Maxwellized. Again, you can see here that we have achieved the energy tail about 20 or 25 electron volts. Here the distributions are somewhat distorted, because this is this transition area between the HiPIMS and ECWVR, so that's not fully established, and that's hard to give some relevant comment on that. Here you can see again the 2D image, which is related with the ECWVR or of the measurement of ECWVR and HiPIMS by the retarding field analyzer. And here you can see that these energies here and here are related with the ion distribution or with the ECWVR. That's the value is about 25 or 30 electron volts, which well corresponds with the plasma potential measured by the Langmuir probe, about 25 volts. So it means that those those ions are accelerated probably due to the sheath between the plasma and the ground. We have done the similar work like reported by Richard van der Sanden yesterday, and we deposit the titanium oxide and we try to find what is the role of the reduced pressure and of the distance from the target with respect of the formation of the titanium oxide films. First, we also measured the ion distribution function, and here you can see the results. The highest energies are at the lowest pressures and close to the target. Actually, this is what one would naturally expect it, and that's decreases the effect of the distance, and the pressure is somewhat corresponds. Actually, the signal here was so strong that we were not able to measure also the ECWVR signal, which is much weaker, and the dynamic range of the retarding field analyzer sensor is not sensitive enough for such a high signals which we have measured. We also did the deposition of thin films, and maybe that's also related with the last question from the previous talk, and we have found that in at such a conditions when the energies of the ions are the highest, we obtain the rutile, which was preferentially oriented, and then with at higher energies we found the deposition of the anatase phases and also the transitions between them. The measurements of the retarding field analyzer is a big advantage that gives us the contribution of all ions, and here you can see the mass spectrum. I hope that you can see the labels which are marked by the blue color. This is the O++, argon++, titanium++, and titanium+, which occur when the HiPIMS discharge is ignited. By other words, if the pure ECWVR is working, then the spectra is nearly the same, just except those lines. So we also try to measure some positive gas ions. For example, you can see it here. This is for the ECWVR discharge, and you can see here that the energies of argon plus, argon++, and oxygen+. Are about again between the 25 and 50 electron volts. Again, we can explain that by the acceleration due to the plasma potential. And when I prepared this talk, I was thinking whether I should include those results which I'm going to present now, because they are not fully understood. But we believe, or let's say that we are nearly sure, that they are measured properly and correctly. The results are following. If the HiPIMS discharge is operated, Then argon plus is nearly the same. This is a blue color. You can see that distribution is nearly the same. But suddenly the argon plus and argon plus plus and oxygen plus plus got the high energetic tails, which reach up the ion energies up to 200 electron volts. So that's somewhat hard to explain it. For that reason, we decided to measure also the ion distribution of the sputtered species. This is for the titanium plus, and this is for the titanium plus plus. And you can see again that we have got the energetic tail up to 100 or nearly 200 electron volts, respectively. Well, we can try. We did some, or we employed some fittings, which are not shown here. And somewhat these energetic tails, yeah, this one part and also this one part, can be somewhat fitted by the Thomson distribution, which gives us the energy which ions gain during the sputtering, which they gain during the sputtering. That's okay. But then, and I should tell just now, also that this fitting well corresponds with this tail, but not with this lower energies, this Thomson distribution. Then we can see somewhere here that there is something like the Maxwellization processes that might be fitted, and we did this by the Maxwell distribution, which can somewhat correspond and also here. But we have to keep in mind that at such a low pressure, the mean three part is about 20 centimeters, which is farther, or which is more than is the distance between the target and the orifice of the mass spec. So by other words, we measure the collisional species, and that's yeah. So then where the question is where this Maxwellization could occur. So these are somewhat fresh results. Might be that, as Hari proposed, there exists some instabilities, and that probably that's related with the extremely low pressure which we have achieved, and with some instabilities where the species could be accelerated. But this is a more or less just only the hypothesis. I don't want to tell speculation, but hypothesis. Okay, I should make the summary of my talk. First of all, I have to apologize for these problems with the beamer. I hope that somewhat we have managed that. So the basic idea was to operate the HiPIMS discharges in a wide range of the pressure, and to tune the energy. One objection can be, okay, why to use the lower pressure when we can achieve this, or when we can control these energies due to the biasing of the target? Yeah, because we try to deal also with the epitaxial growth of the thin films. We try to reduce the impurities, and yeah, the farther the energy can be also controlled by the biasing, completely right. For that reason, we have developed these ions, these HiPIMS assisted discharges, and we found that at low pressure, we are achieving the higher plasma density, also the higher ionization coefficient, and also the distribution functions of both of electron as well as ions can be somewhat controlled. And in that case, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Paper's open for discussion. Yes,
please.
Yeah, thank you.
I have a question about the effect of the assistance with the RF plasma, because you put the 400 watts into that, and is it in a helper mode when the discharge on?
Once again, this is a helicon?
Is the plasma is in the helicon mode?
No, this is not exactly the helicon type of the discharges. This is the case when is this resonance of electron cyclotron wave. Yeah, so that belongs to the family of helicon discharges, but this is not the pure helicon discharge.
It means that for the 13.56 megahertz, the electrocyclone frequency, which corresponds to the magnetic field, is maybe a few gauss, right? Or less than 100 gauss.
Yeah. But we used or for that we used the magnetic field, which is created by this Helmholtz coils, just only about roughly 1 millitesla. That's enough to make the
vibrance shorter. The intention of my question is that the what is the effect of the RF plasma on enhancement of the discharge itself? Because the discharge power itself is quite high compared with the RF in this case. And actually, the plasma density which is maintained by the RF is 1 or 2 orders of magnitude lower.
Yeah, exactly.
So I'd like to ask you, maybe you perform experiments with the with and without RF, and is there any significant difference in plasma density?
Yeah, of course.
How much is it different?
Yeah, so
order of magnitude discussion or factor.
First of all, this question is not so simple because we try to operate this ECW via discharge at low pressure, and without this support at low pressure, we are not able to sustain it.
Yeah.
So that's impossible to measure. If we increase the pressure, then this ECW VR discharge, again, these conditions are not valid for higher pressure. Mm-hmm. So we can talk about some mid-range of the pressures where somewhat we are able to achieve the HiPIMS working separately and also this ECW VR. And then we observed the enhancement about factor of 3, 4, something like that.
I also have some questions about the ECR enhancement you made. One thing is you measured ECR and you mentioned helicons. ECR are different waves than helicon waves. Helicon waves are whistler waves in a bounded plasmas where you are well below the cyclotron frequency.
Yeah.
While cyclotron waves are really useful cyclotron resonance, so they are very, very distinct.
Yeah, but
secondly, both waves are usually launched along the magnetic field lines, and you made a with two Helmholtz coil a magnetic field which is perpendicular, while your launcher is behind the target, as I understood. Or, so it's really perpendicular to the field, which is not in the usual way, since these waves travel along the magnetic field lines, both the cyclotron as well as the helicon wave.
Yeah.
So, therefore, for me, there was a bit of confusion, but probably I just didn't understand it.
Okay, I will try to explain you, hopefully. You mentioned the helicon discharges and ECR discharge. That was what you mentioned. And you are completely right that the helicons are with the lower frequencies and ECR with the nearly resonant or electron cyclotron frequency. But I should point one again that this is not ECR. This is the ECWVR. Yeah. So that's electron cyclotron wave resonance discharge. This is not electron cyclotron resonance. Yeah. So then there exist the frequencies which are somewhat in the middle. Then about the magnetic field, you are completely right that from the Helmholtz coils the lines were something like that, and the wave propagates in such a way, right? And here below we have the magnetic field caused by the magnetron. We measured the field lines by the Gauss probes, and we found that this is somewhat well confined. So in this case, the magnetic fields should not be disturbed heavily. Bigger problem is the deformation of the magnetic field by the high electron density. It was reported in HiPIMS discharges by Ballmark that the high electron density can somewhat deform the magnetic field, and that's by my opinion even more crucial things. When the HiPIMS discharge is ignited, then the the electrons are repelled, and then that's also can deform this weak magnetic field produced by the Helmholtz coils, and yeah, that disturbs the ECWVR effect. Yeah.
One thing I still don't understand is how do you launch with waves? How do you think that you launch with waves? So what is generating with waves? Is it just out of a noise in this pulse, or how do you think you generate these waves?
Yeah, well, maybe I can give you the better answer during the coffee break, having a paper and so on. Using this dispersion diagram, we are working in this range of the frequencies, and then you are completely right that the wave is propagated somewhere here, and here we have the standing wave pattern, yeah, inside this RF RF electrode, which is perpendicular parallel towards the generated magnetic field.
Did you make B dot probe measurements to see the wave field?
No. We are using this just only as some factor for the assistance for the ignition of the HiPIMS discharges. We are not dealing so much with this type of discharge.
Maybe it's a good point for further discussion in the coffee break. Are there any further questions? If not, so thank you once again.